In this module, we're going to look at the concept of Punnett squares, and this will be the first of several, perhaps, at least two modules dealing with the Punnett square. And the purpose of the Punnett square is for us to be able to predict the genotypes that we would expect of offspring from crosses between parents of known genotypes. So for example, let's just start with a simple cross. We'll look at an individual, say, we'll start with one gene. We have gene A. And we have an individual that's homozygous for allele 1 of gene A. What would their gametes look like after meiosis? So if this cell goes through meiosis, we just saw that meiosis will produce half of the gametes carrying one of the chromosomes from this individual, and the other half of the gametes will carry the other. Well, in this case, when you have a homozygous individual, the haplotypes are the same. It's allele 1. Allele 1. So this individual, after meiosis, will produce four different gametes, but each of those carries a chromosome that has gene A, allele 1 in it. I'm going to mark that by a little horizontal line indicating the position of the gene on the chromosome. So there's no genetic variation in the four different gametes each meiosis will produce from a homozygous individual. So what happens if we mate this individual, A1 over A1, cross to another individual that has exactly the same genotype? Well, this individual produces the same sorts of gametes. They'll all just contain gene A, allele 1. So any combination of, say, sperm and oocyte, let's assume that was a female homozygous individual and this was a male, the combination of sperm and oocytes will only be able to produce a diploid cell that contains gene A's allele 1 from both parents, the paternal and the maternal alleles. So we have an individual that's a product of crossing from both homozygous parents is themselves a homozygote. Now it's important, now that we're starting to talk about crosses, to mention briefly generation numbering. When we talk about the first cross, that's usually the P0 or the parental generation. So we'd refer to this as the P0 male, the P0 female. Their offspring is in the first filial generation, which we call the F1 generation. Subsequent generations would be called F2, F3, and so on. Now, stepping back to meiosis and the graphical representation of haplotypes. Remember, haplotypes are the genotypes of individual meiocytes, sperm or eggs. This individual, the male, here's 100%, a line representing 100% of their gametes. So we could divide that into four if you want and put the genotype of each of those four meiocytes along this axis. 100% of these gametes contain allele 1 of gene A. That's the male. If we want to look at the possibilities of what happens when the male's gametes are combined with the female P0's gametes, so we're going to say this is the male parent, P0. Here are the gametes that are produced by the female P0 individual, and again, we know that she is homozygous, she only produces gametes that contain, again, in this example, allele 1. So when we combine any of these gametes with any of those gametes, as in this table, we can fill this table in with the haplotype of dad's gametes. That's one chromosome, slash, just like we write our genotypes separating two different chromosomes, the gamete haplotype that's provided by the mom. And in this case, because each of these individuals are genetically homogenous, they only produce one haplotype of gamete, 100% of the offspring produced from this cross will have this genotype, as we saw here, A1 over A1. So that's the genotype of the F1 generation. And we know this is 100% because it's 100% of the area of this square. The Punnett square, therefore, this is a Punnett square. It's a simple one, probably more simple than you've ever seen in a class before because it only has one outcome. The Punnett square is a graphical representation of the frequency of alleles from a father in his gametes, the frequency of alleles contributed from a mother in her gametes, and the different combinations of haplotypes and genotypes, therefore, that they produce once the sperm and the egg fuse at fertilization. The last cross we looked at, a cross between two individuals homozygous for the same genotype, can also be accomplished by a different cross if we're dealing with an individual that's not from a sexual species. There's also the possibility that you have a single individual, if they're a hermaphrodite, for example, an individual from a species where that sex, the hermaphroditic sex, produces both sperm and eggs, as in many plants, can self-fertilize. And selfing of an individual can also be represented in a Punnett square, because we could look at, again, the gametes from the sperm and their haplotype, and the gametes from the eggs and their haplotype. And we can still know, in this case, that both the sperm and the eggs, even though they're created from the same organism, if that organism's homozygous, they will only produce one genotype, haplotype, in their sperm and one in their eggs, resulting in a genetically identical self-offspring. Now, what happens if we make things a little bit more complicated and we look at a cross between individuals with different genotypes? So here we have two homozygotes. One homozygous for gene A's allele 1, and the other homozygous for gene A's allele 2. How would we set up this Punnett square? So assuming again that the male, which is usually the case, is written on the left, and the female on the right. This is not a convention, it's just a convention I use. I'll put the male's haplotype on the top, and the mom's gamete haplotypes on the side. So what am I going to write here for the haplotypes that the male contributes? He only has version 1 of gene A, so his gametes will, 100% of them, the entire width of the Punnett square, representing 100% of the gametes that this male produces, have A1. The same is true for this female. She's homozygous, so she only produces gametes that contain the second allele of that gene, A2. So now we fill in the Punnett square by copying across, down, and across. We find that the entire volume area of this square is made up of a single genotype. So we have 100% of the F1 generation. This is the P0 generation here, and their gametes. And inside the Punnett square, the F1 genotypes, 100% of them will be homozygous or heterozygous, A1 over A2. So at this point, the Punnett squares are pretty boring. It's just A square with a single cell in it. Here's where we get a little bit more complicated. Let's take a look at the case where we cross a homozygous individual with a heterozygous individual. So for example, let's say we crossed a heterozygous F1 individual with one of their parents. We won't go there. There are two different types of gametes that will be produced from this, again, as the P0 generation. And we have, let's say the dad is the homozygote and the mom is the heterozygote. When we draw out the Punnett square, we're going to put dad's genotype on top. What are we going to draw here for the haplotype of his gametes? Yeah, it should just be A1. Because he's homozygous, only produces one type of gamete. So 100% of his gametes carry that haplotype. Here's where we see something new. What happens when we look at mom's haplotypes? When you have a heterozygote go through meiosis, half, we know by Mendel's law, half of the gametes will contain A1. This is 100% of her gametes, remember, the entire height of this cell. Half of them are going to carry A1, the other half, A2. So now we have a Punnett square that has two different cells. All of them are going to inherit allele 1 from the father. Now we get the difference. Half of mom's gametes carry allele 1. So now we've produced a homozygous A1 over A1 offspring. These are, again, the F1 generation genotypes. What's inside the Punnett square? And down here, we have heterozygotes, A1 over A2. Now, here's a critical part about interpreting Punnett squares. The areas of each cell in the Punnett square represent, graphically, the fraction of the offspring that have that particular genotype. So here we've divided this original box exactly in half, because exactly half of mom's gametes carried A1, and the other half A2. That means that half of her offspring will have the top genotype and half the bottom genotype. Now we're going to look at a setup of a Punnett square that you're probably going to recognize. This is called a monohybrid cross. What monohybrid means, hopefully you'll be able to remember this, is that we're looking at one locus or one gene. And the hybrid in this case is meant to indicate that we're looking at a heterozygote. So a monohybrid cross is defined as crossing two individuals that are heterozygous for the same alleles, allele 1 over allele 2 and allele 1 over allele 2. So that's the P0 generation. We have the P0 father and the P0 mother. Now we need to figure out what are the gametes of the P0 generation? What are their haplotypes? These are genotypes, diploid individuals. We want to know what the constitution is at each locus we're interested in. What are the haplotypes of the gametes? So this should be starting to get pretty easy. If you have a heterozygote, half of them will carry allele 1 from the father, the other half will carry allele 2, and the same is true for the mother. This is great. In diploids, you have two copies of every chromosome. If you're heterozygous, that means that half of your gametes, sperm or eggs, get one of the alleles, the other half get the other. So drawing out what gamete haplotypes we produce makes setting up the Punnett square pretty straightforward. So again, we're going to have the father's gamete haplotypes diagrammed across the top and the mother's down the side. So half of dad's gametes, dividing that axis in half. Half have allele 1, half have allele 2. The same is true from the mom. Half of her oocytes or eggs will have allele 1, and the other half allele 2. Again, this is Mendel's second law, independent assortment, that these alleles are segregating evenly into oocytes and sperm. That's the first law, segregation of alleles. The second law is that there's independent segregation. So we get all possible combinations of allele 1 and allele 2 from mom, and allele 1 and allele 2 from dad. And that's why we fill down and fill across and look at the areas of the different cells in the Punnett square to figure out the frequencies or the percentages of offspring that are likely to contain different genotypes. Remember now, this Punnett square contains the F1 genotypes predicted. These are the anticipated genotypes and their relative frequencies. So now what we need to do to answer a question like, what fraction of the offspring from this cross are going to have homozygous for allele 2, we look at the different genotypes and we'll write them all out separately. So we have allele 1 over allele 1. We have two different cells that have heterozygotes, allele 1 over allele 2. There's one of those, there's two of those, and then there's one cell that has allele 2 over allele 2, homozygous allele 2. And that is the basis for a ratio. I'm sure you recognize the 1:2:1 ratio, which is the expected outcome of different genotypes, homozygous for allele 1, heterozygous, and homozygous for allele 2, that you expect out of the monohybrid cross. So to summarize the monohybrid cross, the Punnett square is a graphical representation of the gametes produced by the P0, or parental, female and male, and how they come together in random combinations at fertilization to produce an expected frequency of different genotypes in the F1 generation. So I want to leave you with a particular question to think about for next time. What sort of cross would produce, so we want to know a cross, something crossed with something else, what kind of cross in the P0 generation would produce an F1 generation that you know you're absolutely certain all of the individuals will have homozygote genotypes? So bring the answer to that question with you when we talk in class next.